Hi, I am Kajal Puri. I am doing Masters of Computer Science at University of Grenoble Alpes in France. I have just joined my master's after completing 1 year as a data scientist at Fractal Analytics, Bangalore, India. And today I am going to talk about speech recognition and vice versa as well, a little bit about it. So these are my social media handles in case you want to reach out. So basically, I'll start from the speech recognition basic definition. So daily-to-daily life, just like the vision or language, a most important part of human life is voice or speech. So speech recognition is when a computer can detect whatever you have said in whatever language you have said, in whatever expressions you have said. Ideally, an AI should be able to convert whatever you have said accurately into the form of text. So that's speech recognition. And its applications are very general, like the automatic generated captions on YouTube. Not on YouTube anymore, I guess. This is the perfect example of automatic generation of captions. So yeah. Second is the voicemail transcription. It used to exist probably like 5 to 6 years back, and it was very bad in nature. These days, obviously, its accuracy has increased, but because of all the internet revolution, telephone companies, telecom companies have stopped using that. The third application that is very widely used is Siri, Cortana, Echo, Google Home, etc. Like you can give an instruction to your Google Mini that, you know, switch on the lights and it'll probably interpret. And if it's not able to interpret, it'll probably Google search for you and dictate the results. Yeah. So these are some basic applications. This particular diagram shows you the high-level interpretation of how speech recognition systems work. So what happens is, generally, whenever we are uttering a word or a sentence, each word, syllable, has a particular sound wave associated to it. So whenever, even when you are saying hello, a sequence of sound waves will be generated, which will then be detected by neural networks, and using many algorithms like pattern recognition or deep learning algorithms, you can identify, you can match that particular sound wave to the word or syllable or a sentence, and then you can predict what the original sound wave was generated. Like in this case, the sound wave was hello. Then when we pass it through the neural network, after a lot of pre-processing and pattern matching, it predicts as hello. So generally the word here is very predictable, so it is predicted accurately. But when we are saying a lot of words or sentences put together in a continuous way, the text generation is not always correct, just like this one. So basically, ASR, so this is the overview of how ASR systems work. First is the speech segment extraction. So what happens is that when we are speaking, we are not just speaking a word or a syllable, we are speaking in a continuous chain of sentences or words. And how generally it's done is that your model or your during the pre-processing phase, your each sentence will be segmented in a different words. So let's say you have uttered a sentence that I am at PyConFR. So how computer will interpret is that it will segment it to I am at and PyConFR. Like the segmentation can vary, but yeah, first of all, it will segment your whole speech or the whole word you have said, and then various speech processing techniques can be applied on it to refine it. Let's say that when you are saying this in a public public place and there will be a lot of background noise. So you can refine it more so that the background noise is lesser, or you can enhance the quality of the sound. So there are a lot more steps that you can do in the signal or in the speech pre-processing part. And then there are two ways basically to do the modeling. So one is that you can already use the pre-trained vector or embeddings that are already available on the internet. The second is that you can train your own model as well. So if you are already using the pre-trained vectors of a model, then what you can do is you can just take the input sample of your audio files and apply the statistical or pattern matching techniques on it, and probably you will be able to get the answers. So like answers in the sense the prediction of whatever you have uttered. And the second is that you can first get the training data and then train your own model. You can probably use any architecture that's there on the internet, or you can actually customize that. It takes a lot of time and memory, but in some cases it's totally worth it. Then after training and pattern matching, you can get the output. So yeah, that's like you can see it there. So what are the challenges of ASR? So the first challenge of ASR is the human accent that we can see here as well. If you would have noticed that like in this system, whenever like in the world, we all come from different nations, and human accent is a very integral part of us. So generally what happens is that the data set available on the internet are of one type data set, that is probably the American or British native speakers. So that's why there is a lot of bias in the data set that is freely available already. So that is why Siri will be able to detect what a Native American has said much more accurately than what a French or an Indian person would be saying to it. So that's a really big problem of ASR, because you cannot just say something. A human cannot be a robot. So that's why every human will have its own unique voice or accent, which is generally ignored by an ASR system. So that's a big problem that people are working on it. I want to show you a quick demo of what it looks like. I'll probably show it at the end so that we don't have any technical difficulties. So the second problem of ASR is the background noise. So in an ideal situation, you will be sitting in a room and saying something to Siri. But that's not always going to be the case, because you can be traveling or you can be in a park, and a background noise plays a significant role. So most of the data sets that are available on internet, they are very ideal. They do not have any background noise, so you don't need much refining. But in a real time, it's a problem, because whenever you are speaking, you will have a little bit, most of the times you will have a little bit of background noise. So sometimes it interferes and the system is not able to predict it correctly. So this is a graph which shows the intersection of accent and background noise, and you can see that the most word error rate is highest when there is an Indian native speaker and it has a background noise in it, which is pretty obvious. Yeah, so the third is the misinterpretation of homophones. So homophones are the words that sound exactly the same, that might have same spellings as well, but they have different meanings, or the meaning is different at different parts. So the perfect example is we have won the match, and it can easily be predicted by an ASR system is we have won the match, which totally changes the meaning of the sentence. And there are a few number of more examples. So what happens is probably you'll not say it like it's not the correct structure, we went to see the sea, but in the human conversation, you all you often say sentences that are not maybe English, that are not maybe correct in the structure, but that is used very much in the conversation. So these are the some points that will be used in the conversation, and that you can actually tell Siri to do something, but you can say that they are maybe grammatically or structurally not very English correct. So yeah. But yeah, so the Siri always or most of the times misinterprets homophones. So that is a problem that ASR has to, like a perfect AI should not be having, because generally humans understand what we are trying to say. So the fourth point is the overlapping sounds. So what happens is generally when humans are talking, sometimes or another, different people are talking at the same time, and still we are able to differentiate that who is speaking what. But an ASR is not able to, and one of the reason is the one of the reason is the non-availability of data set. All the data sets are single speaker and single stream available, and there is no overlapping, and sometimes there are no multiple speakers. So that's why it's trained on such type of data set, and it gives faulty results. An ideal AI should be able to segment between the two personalities and who is trying to say what. There are other minor problem in ASR as well. First is the varying environment. Let's say that you are giving an instruction to an AI system, and you're walking from your home to outside. So probably in your home you will not have much noisy sound, but when you'll go outside you will probably have a noisy background. And sometimes because of the change in a little bit of environment causes the ASR to fail, which should not be the case ideally. The second is a very important part, which is the artifacts from the hardware. So some even these days your phones are not supposed to get the perfect quality of whatever you are saying as in the audio, and because of the quality the ASR might not be able to detect the current sound waves, and it might not understand what you're saying. The third is the audio and compression artifacts. This mainly happens not in the real time, but when you're, let's say, trying to transcript a voice transcription system, it can be a good example of it, that when you have heard the whole audio and when you're trying to compress it, then the quality of the audio can be lost. There are many other factors as well, like the age of the speaker. A child would have a different kind of voice or the pronunciation of words from an old age speaker. The most important factor is high computation tools necessary. So to convert a speech into a text requires a lot of processing, pre-processing, and so you will need high RAM or maybe as well the data storage. So that's the issue in like ASR. So what is the need of an ASR? So nowadays we know that there are going to be self-driving cars maybe after some time. So the one thing is that they can help you like in multitasking. So let's say that when you are driving, you can actually call a system in your car that, you know, you should turn on the lights or switch on switch the temperature of the air conditioner in your car, and much more stuff like that. Second is boon for people with disability. So 10% of right now human population is disabled in some way or another. So this is a boon for them that they don't have to use they don't have to use their like fingers or hands in some way, and only then the system will be able to understand them. Third is can be used both by literate and illiterate, which is obvious. Even a person who is not properly educated can at least communicate in the language, so it will be very easier for them to give an instruction or ask a question to the automatic speech recognition system, and they'll get their answer back. Fourth, very important point as a social perspective is that there are a lot of languages in the world that are on the verge of extinction. So let's say that you have, let's say that Google has already released an ESR system which can understand a particular language, endangered language, and then the people of those groups can actually use it, and they can help it to prevent the extinction of that language and preserve it as it can be spoken or talked by multiple people to the AI direct. Fourth is, like, it's very obvious. And the fifth is faster way of instruction. So this is also a very important part, because when you are trying to write a text or you're using some other way of communication, it might be a little less faster than what the human speech can do. So, like, you these days you don't even need a click. You can just talk to your phone and probably your work will be done. So these are the three basic types of an ASR system. The first is the template based. So it has actually outdated. So what happens in this case is you already have a set of templates, and if the person is trying to communicate with you, then you can match the communication of that person with a particular template, and if it does not match, then you can simply say to the person that the answer that you are looking for is not in our system. The second is the knowledge or rule based. This is applied in most of the IVRS system that we call customer cares and all. They have a pre-defined rules, and if your question is out of the rules, you cannot really communicate with them. So, and you have a special human that is employed there. So that is the second. And the third is statistical approach, which is used most commonly these days. And this is based on data science particularly, because you have to collect a lot of data and train it on a particular deep learning architecture. Then you apply a lot of pattern recognition or matching statistical approaches, and then you can get your result. So like now, how it can be done. So there are two ways to do it. One is to either program a model by yourself, and the second is to use an existing API. So these are the few APIs that I have tested. So the best API is the Google Speech API, but the problem is that it takes a lot of money to pay, because I think after up to 1,000 or 10,000 requests, these are not free. So that can be a big challenge for students or for research purposes, because you don't have that much of funds to invest. There are few, so basically the APIs also have different features, and The IBM Watson APIs does not give you a very customized overview as much as Google or Microsoft can do for you. And also in these APIs, you can select your language. So you can select different language. You can select different the frequency of different words that are spoken. So these are the few features. DeepSpeech is one of the Mozilla's open source library, which converts speech to text. It's based on the Baidu's research paper, and it is also implemented in Python and TensorFlow. So basically, as a developer, I have used DeepSpeech, and the reason is, like, the reason are as follows. So first is that the development of DeepSpeech is totally open source. Like, you can like you can contribute or you can actually check the code, what are the features that are behind those functions. Second is the hyperparametric tuning of models. So you can see the which type of model has been implemented, and you can actually play with the hyperparameters according to the task you need or the kind of data set you have. Third is cost effective because of its open source in nature. Fourth is batch processing. So a lot of APIs like Microsoft and Google, they do not provide this service, which is to batch process and check how much time or how much accuracy of a particular batch of your data set this is giving. You can train your own model from scratch. This is generally very expensive, but in case if you have resources, you can do it. And I think this will be worth it if you have a really good data set. Distributed training is also not done there. Pre-trained models. So let's say that in case you want to, you don't want to do all this stuff and you just want to get the already trained embeddings and you just want to reuse it on your data set, that you can do with it as well. And it gives better results in general with the real-time speech data, which is probably the problems we are working on to build an ideal AI. So this is the result comparison of all the APIs. The comparison is generally done on first the clean data set and then the noisy data set, so as to know if your model is not overfit by a particular data set or it works equally well on a real-time human data set. So the DeepSpeech has given the best results so far. It's pretty close to Google API, but that's the, I think, reason why most of the developers want to use it. So this was all about speech to text, which is considered almost a solved problem these days, except for those few challenges. Now the world is heading towards the text to speech, which is if you are talking to Siri, it must give you reply back in a speech that is almost human-like. So basically, when you're talking to an AI assistant, you can easily distinguish. Let's say that a person doesn't know who is human and who is an AI assistant, so it can easily distinguish that a robot-like voice is an AI assistant. So what they're trying to do is they're trying to put more number of emotions and to make it sound more like human, so that you're not able to distinguish if, like, who was talking to you on the phone. And this was probably this was demonstrated on the Google I/O 2018 as well by Sundar Pichai. So the major two parameters that are detected on which text to speech is intelligibility and how humanly it sounds. So intelligibility is generally the hardware or the background problem. It's like the quality of audio, how clear it is, and whether it's listenable or not, which are not that tough to achieve. The more tougher part is how humanly it sounds. So the emotions, the timing and the structure of sentences, and as well the pronunciation. So these are the human features that varies from every other human to other. So it's not just so basically if you want an AI to sound like yourself, you must the AI must know you, how you speak and how you deliver your sentences or what kind of pronunciation you have. This is the problem that they are working on. To solve this problem, there are two architectures that are really popular these days. One is the WaveNet and second is the sample RNN. So the WaveNet architecture is generally so there are basically two type of models, generative and adversarial. So this is a autoregressive generative model. So what it does is it uses generally in the speech recognition we use recurrent neural networks, because our speech is a sequence of audio wave signals, and recurrent neural networks are designed to do that task. But it uses convolutional neural networks instead, and so they are not exactly the convolutional neural networks. They are dilated in a way that they can detect the various sequences and get the minimum sample of an audio, and then they apply various pattern recognition algorithms on it. So what the experiment was done on, that it was trained on the human data, and the output produced was just like human, that it was able to it was able to detect the emotions, the sounds that humans produce, but it was not able to detect the right kind of text structure. So it was just blabbering in the in one way or another. The good and the bad thing of this is that it takes 4 minutes to generate 1 second of audio. Some people that say that it's lesser for a start, and some people say that it's really good for a start. So probably we'll have to look out for more research papers, and I think down the line they will like really lessen it to probably 1 minute or 30 seconds. So let's see what is they are going to be in future. So this is the structure of WaveNet, which is not the usual convolution or the neural network. So this is the diluted convolution neural network, which was just discovered to accomplish this task. Okay, sorry. This is the second type of architecture. This is sample RNN, which is not explored much up to the date. It is also used to generate the audio samples. So what happens is that multiple RNNs are connected in a particular sequence, and the audio is given to the top layer of the recurrent neural network, and it gets sampled until it's at its most shortest sample, up to the last layer of the architecture. So it is computationally 500 times faster, but it does not give that much of good results as WaveNets. And it gives almost equivalent, but not that good still. So not much can be said about it because it has not been experimented with. So if somebody among you is looking to experiment with text-to-speech, you can probably explore this area more because. So this is the architecture of sample RNN. So these are the slide actually that I just got it by attending the few tasks in the morning. So this picture is the transcription generated by this module by an Indian speaker, and you can read it. So the red lines are the red marked sentences are probably they are like totally not in the they are like totally contrasting. They don't totally match at all with the things that the person was trying to speak or interpret. Whereas these are the things that was spoken by a guy who has a very good English accent as compared to the another. So it doesn't make sense completely, but I think it has still lesser number of out of the box character words. So I think this is the probably live demonstration of ASR. So these are the references that I have included in this, my diagrams and the results were taken from these resources. And this is my email ID in case you have a question.
Thank you for this talk. We have time for questions. Yes?
Yes. I didn't understand the use of WaveNet and sample RNN in the context of DeepSpeech. Is it other?
No. So DeepSpeech and WaveNet are. So basically, his question is how is WaveNet used in DeepSpeech? So DeepSpeech is for now used just for the speech to text generation. That is, if you are speaking a text an accurate text should be generated. Whereas the WaveNet is doing the opposite. It's converting a text to the speech. Yes.
Do you have an example of the Python API we can use for all this one?
So basically DeepSpeech has more both Python as well as TensorFlow implementation. So
can you show us a snippet or something?
Sample CNN. I think I have actually encoded this one. Just let me check. Yeah, so this is one article reference that I have taken. Okay, so I'll just add it as a resource in here of the sample code that I have tried. I'll just add it here. Or you can just ping me on my email and I'll send it to you personally. Yeah.
Yes, I don't have a question. Would you be able to show us a video?
Oh, yes, yes, yes. Oh, thanks for reminding me. Unmute it. And then just okay. Okay, and now
okay,
yes.
Maybe put the mic close to the headphones or something.
Yes.
So it's not,
the voice is not coming.
It's not playing.
No, it's playing. Okay. Whose laptop is this? Probably he can help us out. Whose laptop is this?
Mine, yeah.
Yeah, probably you can help us out. I have actually unmuted the sound and it's proper, but
no, but there's a problem here.
Yes. Hi. You have to
that
find
way.
It. Yes. Just play it. No.
No?
Yeah, just play it.
But it's there. The sound.
It's not even playing here. Oh, you have attached this.
Yes, but the sound is here.
Okay, yes.
No idea.
So you can, I'll probably leave the link with you guys for the slides and you can check it. This was the demonstration of two presidents of India speaking and it was the combination of all the problems that existed together in an ASR. So there was background noise, there was an accent problem and there was overlapping of sounds. So this is the one example. So the red text is basically the wrong predicted text, and you can see in a perfect audio there can be a very less number of wrong predicted text. And okay, and in the real-time audio there can be multiple wrong predicted text because of all the problems, and they will be existing in real time. So although it is said that YouTube closed captioning is really good, it is good, but only if it sees the ideal case, which is not going to be the case always or even most of the times in human life. So yeah, probably you can hear the audio and see it yourself. I'll just leave the link of slides with you guys. Thank you so much.